During a stroll through the countryside, I found myself on the road above a tunnel through which the railroad tracks pass. Down below was a tiny station, which was maintained by the signalman who was standing near the great iron bars, which are the means of switching the tracks. I shouted down to him, "Hello down there!" Before he could answer, there was a vibration in the earth which quickly turned into a violent pulsation as a train roared out of the tunnel. As the train disappeared down the tracks, he folded his signal flag and beckoned me to come down. I found my way and joined him at the small building. He looked at me as if he was afraid. When I asked if anything was wrong, he said he thought he might have seen me before. When I asked where, he pointed at the red light at the mouth of the tunnel. I was quite puzzled as I followed him into the little house. Inside, there was a fire, a desk, and a telegraphic instrument, and that was all. I asked what he meant when he pointed to the red light. Instead of answering, he asked a most strange question. What made me call out, "Hello down there"? Why, those exact words. When I asked why those exact words were important, he said he would tell me on our next visit. But please, he said, don't call out. The following night, I returned to the signal station and joined him inside. He told me that he had mistaken me for someone else. When I asked who, he said he didn't know for sure, because the person's left arm is always across his face as he waves violently with his right arm. Then he explained, "One moonlight night, I was sitting here when I heard a voice cry out, 'Hello down there!' I looked out of the door and saw a person standing by the red light, waving his right arm. The voice seemed quite hoarse as it cried, 'Hello down there! Look out! Look out!' I ran to the figure, but just as I got to the place where it was standing, it was gone. I stood there in amazement, listening to the eerie wind blowing through the telegraph wires above me. Within 6 hours, there was news of a horrible crash at the other end of the tunnel. That was a year ago. A few months later, I saw the figure again, and the whole sequence was repeated. Within a few hours, a train came out of the tunnel and stopped at my station. I could hear the terrible cries as the conductor told me that a passenger had just suffered a violent death on board. The figure appeared again last week, but there has been no accident. I fear that this time it will be me. I tried to talk him out of his fear, but was unable to calm him, so I left. I came back the next day to find a train stopped at the little house. I walked up to a group of men and asked what was wrong. The engineer told me that the signalman was killed this morning, cut down by the engine. He had changed the light, but somehow did not jump clear of the oncoming train. The engineer said, "I saw him and blew the whistle. When he didn't react, I waved violently with my right arm as I covered my eyes with my left so that I would not see the disaster about to take place." I had to ask, "What did you actually cry out?" Then he told me his exact words were, "Hello down there! Look out! Look out!"
How old am I? Not nearly as old as I look. Been that way ever since that night when my hair turned white. That night? Well, I was driving home from a dance up near Ridgewater on this little road that leads to the big highway. It's pretty dark and winding for at least 10 miles, bumpy and curving through a forest so thick that the branches keep scraping on the sides of the car like they were trying to keep you from getting away. Suddenly, there's somebody in the road right in front of the car. I jammed on the brakes and stopped just in time. There was this shivering young woman. She had jumped into the middle of the road as if she could stop a car just by holding up her hand. She told me that she'd been in an accident and her car was a wreck. Then she asked me if I'd drive her home. She looked so cold and miserable. I let her in and even threw my white jacket around her because she was wearing a thin silk dress without even a sweater. Well, we started off for her house. And after more turns than you would believe, we pulled up in front of a very tidy little cottage with all of its lights turned on like a Christmas tree. She just sat there looking all worn out like she had used up every bit of energy she could spare. "Please ring the bell and see if my mother's home," she said. "The bell is on the left near the brass knob." I rang the bell and the lady who answered looked like an older version of my hitchhiker. Before I even had a chance to speak, she said, "Don't say a word. Just come this way." It all seemed very strange, but I followed her anyway. Up the stairs, down a hall, and into a very pretty room. A girl's room, I could tell. And on the table by the bed, there was a picture of a young girl. It was my hitchhiker. But all around the picture, there was a black border. Then the woman beckoned me to follow her back downstairs. I followed her down the stairs, out the door, and past the car. There was nobody in it. We walked a little further and came to a little private cemetery with a grillwork fence around it. We went in and stopped in front of a grave that looked newer than the others. The woman pointed to the grave and said, "My daughter. She was killed in an automobile accident last summer, and every night someone, some stranger, brings her home again." I was terrified. I turned away and left her there, but not before I noticed something sticking out from under the gravestone. I ran to my car and drove back home as fast as I could. It wasn't until I was in my own house and in my own bedroom that I discovered that my hair was white. Pure white, the same color as my jacket. That's what was sticking out from under that gravestone, just like it had been there ever since.